Welcome back. So as usual, I'm going to do our little recap and what I will see. Well, we arrived at the core of the business. Namely, we derived the Einstein-Fields equations. And we did it once as Einstein did, namely by just reasoning. So he was looking for a rank 2 tensor, rank 2 tensor because he realized that if you want to generalize the concept of a four momentum for fields in general, including matter fields, you need the energy momentum tensor. Energy momentum tensor that, as we've seen, is popping up thanks to the Noether theorem, right? We just started with a Lagrangian describing our system, and then we asked ourselves what are the quantities that are conserved for this system. And we got to know, well, that's the energy momentum tensor, and we got the relationship of the energy momentum tensor with respect to the Lagrangian that described the system. Then we start to investigate a little bit the properties of energy conservation and conservation of quantities in general for general relativity. And we introduced new tools, new mathematical tools. First of all, we were investigating maps between different manifolds. Remember, we defined just a map that was going from one manifold to another manifold. Okay? Don't think like I'm moving there is a direction here, like I'm going from this manifold into this other manifold, because I could as well do like that. That's the same. The prime is just a label, okay? Then, once we had a map between two manifolds, meaning a map tells you I'm starting from this point belonging to the manifold, you see it's swallowing one point of the manifold, I'm arriving at another point on the other manifold. Then we pushed on the construction of on our mathematical construction, and we introduced the push forward that was sending a vector from, it was defined on a tangent space of the manifold M to another vector located somewhere else on the other manifold M prime, actually on the tangent space on the other manifold M prime. So it was a map that was going from the tangent space of a point belonging to the manifold M to the tangent space belonging to the other manifold M prime, another point on that manifold that we can call G. And again, we're talking about tangent space because vectors live on tangent spaces. Then we defined the pullback, so that's the push forward. Then we had the pullback, which was instead a map that was sending a one form belonging to the manifold M prime, belonging to the position G. And again, being a one form, was living on the dual on the tangent space on the manifold M prime. And again, was going to the tangent space, the dual of the tangent space of the manifold M, defining the position P. And the two was constructed such we had a consistency between the vector and the one form leaving, where is it? Here. Yeah, here. The vector and the one form that was leaving on M, so the scalar product of the two, was equal to the scalar product of these other two on M prime. Okay? This was the key to define the consistency, or actually to build up these two mathematical instruments. And these were definitions. We constructed them. Then, based on that, we restricted ourselves to a diffeomorphism, which is a one-to-one map, which is invertible. And the diffeomorphism was going from the tangent M to the manifold M to the manifold M. You can think of them as two identical manifolds. So it's a map between two identical manifolds. You see that we are recycling all of this concept, except for the fact now this guy has exactly the same structure of this other guy. Right? This guy has the same structure of this other guy, and we write M and M. Before, what happens? What is this guy doing? Well, we have our manifold M, we have a point P, our diffeomorphism in sending us to another point. You see, from one point to another point. Then we have seen how this is related to coordinate transformations. And we have as well seen how diffeomorphism can be generated out of vector fields. And the way around, if you have a vector field, sorry, if you have a diffeomorphism, you can generate a vector field. Vector flow, right? Remember, we had a vector or tensor field that's completely generic. I say vector, but this is valid for vector one forms and all of that. This guy, you see, is a function. Once we express his coordinate, is a function of a coordinate. If we want to write it in a more in a coordinate free way, that's what this guy would be, right? We have a tensor which is at evaluated at position P. So you have to think at a tensor field as a map that is giving you a tensor field. So let's call it so tensor of type NM. So that's a tensor of type NM. And it's going to give you another tensor of type NM. So it's swallowing, is a map that is swallowing a point on the manifold. And at that position on the manifold, it's going to tell you that's the tensor that you have there. And you have a map which is smooth. It means that you are, if you have a position P, and now for a tensor, I just take a type 1, 0, just to simplify, so a vector. If you have a vector defined in this location, you can ask to your map, what is the vector that I have here? So I have my other point, the point number 2. And I let this map tell me, here I have a vector that is like that. It's smooth in the sense that if you are defining an arbitrary line on our manifold and you're asking what is the vector field, you're not going to get something like this, and then at an infinitesimal distance separation from this point, you have something like that. And then, something like that. It looks kind of random, there are jumps, okay? That's not the case. What you get is something smooth, like the wind, okay? The wind, you describe it with a vector field, and the vector flow is the one that you obtain once you define the line that is tangent to the vectors at all positions. So you start with one initial condition, you decide a point, I'm starting here, at this position I have this vector that is described by my vector field, and I define the line which is tangent. You move a bit, you find another vector. You move a bit, you find another vector, and so on, all over the places. That's your vector flow. And you understand that you can, this guy is giving you a very precise trajectory, if you wish. And therefore, you can understand that you can associate a diffeomorphism that is sending you from here to here, from here to here, to here, to here, to here, to here, and so on. That's an entire manifold. Okay, so you see the relationship between the vector flow, so a vector field, and the coordinate transformations, which can be described through a diffeomorphism. Then what have we done? Why are we doing all this machinery? Well, that's important because then you know about the coordinate transformations, which are extremely important in physics because these allow you to help your life, to simplify your life, so to make your life better. And the other step was not only that, the other goal that we were trying to achieve was not only that, but was to define a new instrument that allow us to better understand conservations in general relativity. And that's why we introduced the Lie derivatives. Lie derivatives, which were called L, like Lie, which are based on a vector field that can be related to a diffeomorphism, right? And we were asking ourselves, what is the Lie derivative of some tensor, which could be the metric, which could be the energy momentum tensor. And we were asking ourselves, when is this guy equal to zero? What does it mean that? This guy is the condition for which, if I have a tensor, I impose this guy, and for the only free parameter that I have is the vector field that is described on the entire manifold. If I have this condition, which is always met, then it means that this tensor T is not changing along the vector flow described by my vector field V. Okay? So here we have our vector field V at another position, The Lie derivatives based on this vector field is going to be zero when I move along these lines. And why is this relevant? Because if we are now taking our arbitrary tensor, the metric, then we have that the metric is not changing along the vector flow described by this vector field. And there is where we have the conservation of the energy momentum tensor. We have the conservation of quantities, as we've seen in the previous lectures. And when this condition is met, we call this guy killing vector field. So the killing vector field is the vector field that gives you this condition. That's extremely important. The Lie derivative is somewhat some more sophisticated technique. It's not usually, introductory lectures like this one. But I think it's important that you see that because it allows you, all of that allows you to better understand coordinate transformations. It allows you to better understand gauge transformations, so infinitesimal transformations that we are going to use in the next lectures. And the relationship of conserved quantities. So I think that's a cute thing to see. Then we continued, and after having derived the Einstein field equations by reasoning, by looking at the need that Einstein had to introduce to find out this tensor, we made exactly the same derivation with a variational approach. Variational approach that allowed us to find out the Hilbert action. Hilbert action that allow us, by looking at the variation of the Hilbert action set to zero, to realize the fact, oh, damn it, if whenever I have this action, I actually end up in finding out the very same equation of motion for our field. The Einstein tensor pops up. Okay? Then what have we done? Well, that's for the vacuum. So that's there were only properties related to the curvature. Therefore, it only describes the space-time, the curvature only, therefore the space-time only. And therefore, this is valid for vacuum, right? There's no matter, no energy, momentum across the universe. So the following step was to add a matter contribution. And with matter contribution, I mean any field. Any field that can be described through an energy momentum tensor. So that's the jargon when you speak about matter, is that you speak about fields in general. So what we did? We had to enrich our action. So we had the one for the field, and then we had to introduce a new term which was related to matter. Then again, so this would have been our full action, and again, least action principle equal to zero, we get to understand, to realize that again we get exactly, now that's another constant, k, let's write it 8 pi g over c4 mu mu. Where in this approach we even manage to define the energy momentum tensor in a slightly alternative form by investigating the variation of the action Sm. Okay? And the two that we derived through the Noether theorem, and this one, you can check yourself, they are give you exactly the same result whenever you introduce, you use the same Lagrangian. Nice. Then what we did was to go back to a concept, which was the one about energy conservation, where we had the fact that we know that in special relativity, whenever this quantity, you see T nu, nu, these quantities, these four quantities, are actually conserved. These are conserved quantities of our system. To arrive at general relativity, when we did it at the beginning down there, what we did was to use the strong equivalence principle and just say, okay, I know that the derivatives, standard derivatives, becomes covariant derivative, therefore this guy holds. But in the process, and again you see the importance of this concept, we realized the fact that this was just not the strong equivalence principle. That's something that is intrinsic, that's popping up, because this is something intrinsic of general relativity, on the very core of general relativity. It depends on the fact that general relativity is a diffeomorphism invariant theory. It doesn't, you can change, you can apply a diffeomorphism, you can identify to your theory based on some tensor and a metric, you can apply a diffeomorphism, you get another theory. But this other theory gives you exactly the same physical properties, the same physical description, the description of the very same universe, in this case, gravity. So this guy is an intrinsic, he's in the core of general relativity. If you want, he's inherited by the construction, okay? But you see that the relationship between the two and the deep mathematical nature of that concept. Good. Then I also mentioned that, yeah, this is the only tensor that can be used, because you can say, okay, I use this Lagrangian, but I could use another one, I get some other tensor. Yeah, it's true, and actually you can do that. But if you want to stick to the assumptions of GR, meaning we are in a four-dimensional space, we want that the energy momentum tensor is conserved, as we explained. We want our theory to be based on the metric. Then G mu nu is, and then, sorry, we want our theory which is up to second derivatives in the metric G, then the only theory that you can build up is G mu nu plus a term related to the cosmological constant. That's the only one. If you have that, you have a unique solution. And there is a theorem for that, which is called Lovelock's theorem. I'm not going to prove it, but it's nice that you know that this guy exists. You can look into that if you are curious about that. Nice, that's unique if you stick to these assumptions. But what about if we loosen our assumptions? Do we still get some gravity theory? Yes, we get some gravity theory which might have some additional property, or it gives you the prediction for observables, for observations that should not look like the one of general relativity. So they're distinguishable theory, you get different results. Then I already insisted several times of this point, despite this is a GR course, I try to keep your mind a little bit open and let you see all the possibilities that you have, or well, all, the main possibilities that you have to enlarge, expand your theory and get a richer set of physics, which may be needed or may not be needed. Because it's going, these additional features are going to be introduced in the theory and accepted by the entire community if we realize the fact that we need them to prove some observations. For example, I'm going to show you some other effects that have been produced, that are being predicted by general relativity, and that are actually, and that proves the fact, yeah, we need a theory which is more complex than Newtonian theory. We already have seen the perihelion shift, gravitational lensing, all of that. There are other effects as well. Frame dragging is the one that we are going to see. And it's something that can be measured. So whenever you have observations that disprove your proven, your previous theory, that's the only thing that you can do in physics. You can only disprove a theory. You can never prove one. Okay? You prove it up, you are satisfied about your theory up to the point in which it represents the current observations. If you have additional observations, can disprove this theory and they push forward to have another understanding about the underlying physics. Okay? So people, that's why people are investigating also other theories, because GR works, but we can try out, okay, I get this theory, I get other predictions. Are they satisfied? Do we see that? So whenever you have the prediction, you can search into the data to set up observations and to set up experiments to see if those observations are actually there, or these predictions are actually fulfilled or not. Okay, that's the game. And I'm telling you, there are zillions of theories on the market. Okay, everyone invents his own theory. Good. What are these ways to enrich our theory? Well, one would be to drop the fact of having torsion free. Torsion different than zero. The other one was to let the non-metricity tensor different than zero. Another one could be to get our Hilbert action and make it more flexible. So we have our you have the Lagrangian, which is embedding to our Hilbert action, which is equal to R minus G. This was to make the four-dimensional element volume invariant. This is the simplest scalar that we can use containing the curvature, containing double derivatives of the metric. So that's the simplest scalar, Lagrange, that we can use. But people came up with, okay, this is nice, it's cute, it's work, but let's try to make it a little bit more flexible. And so people came up with the so-called F of R theories. F of R theories, in which we are saying, okay, here I have R, but actually, this is a function of R. And the function of R is actually the identity. Now let's try to make a theory which can reproduce general relativity once we are using F equal to identity. But that also allows for more complex behaviors. Therefore, from our Einstein tensor, which is this guy, we arrive at defining a new tensor which has more terms. The first one of which is the derivative with respect to R of the function that we are assuming, times R mu nu minus 1 half F of R, and then we have G mu nu minus F prime of R, covariant derivative of this guy, mu nu, double covariant derivative, actually, G mu nu G alpha beta, F prime, R, and then again double derivative with respect to alpha and beta. Okay? So we are enriching our Lagrangian, and by enriching our Lagrangian we can get these terms. And you realize the fact that with this construction we can recover exactly the behavior of general relativity. We can get that the E tensor is identical to the G mu nu tensor. And with F prime, I mean F prime of R is the F over the R. So that's the derivative with respect to R. So you see that if this guy F is the identity, the derivative of F prime is just one. Therefore, we have R and R, R mu nu, which is contained, I didn't write it down, but you remember, which is the one that we have in the Einstein tensor. Then we have F of R, but this is the identity. Therefore, this is minus one half R of G mu nu. Then these are double derivative of this guy, and these are equal to zero. Therefore, you recover the Einstein tensor. Why are people doing that? Well, this is a cheap way to kind of incorporate in a mega flexible way possible other theories. And you incorporate many other possible theories because what you can do is just to change your function f. You get the same mathematical machinery, you change your f, Gesundheit, and you get your other possible observations. You get your other predictions. Okay? And you can do it in a parametric way because, for example, this f could be a polynomial. And therefore, you have all terms. And then you can fit your data with these terms and you realize, all of these are equal to zero, but these terms are active. And so on and so forth. So you can build up the theory as you want in this way. Then I let you on the lecture notes also. This is used, okay? So this is still on the market, it's used. Now a theory that is not anymore used, is not anymore in fashions, are the Brains-Dickey theories. Theory is one, not plural. And I just put it in your lectures just to let you see that you can build up a theories on different mathematical objects, right? For example, on a scalar field. That's Newtonian gravity, right? We have our potential phi, that's a scalar field. We can have a vector theory based on a vector field. Oops, that's here. For example, electrodynamics. We have the four potential, right? Vector potential, this is a vector field. We can have a tensor theory based on a tensor field. And, that's GR. That's the metric. When we solve look for the equation of motion based on our action, the field that we are going that we are trying to constrain is the metric G. Now with this theory, what you're going to have is a scalar field. I'm using a different letter because this guy is different. So you have a scalar field and you have as well a tensor field. You have two of them. And the reason of introducing this guy is to have an additional coupling between this potential and matter. So you have an additional coupling with matter through this field phi. And what is this guy doing? Well, in effect, he's giving you a G, which is not anymore constant. Okay, you have a G which depends on the position x mu, because it depends on the coupling with matter, therefore with the energy momentum tensor of matter. And if you have a region in space where you have more energy momentum tensor, for example, close to a planet, close to a star, or whatever, then G is different. Yeah? No. G is the, you're right, G is the is the Newtonian constant. Okay? So the prefactor that is in front of your Newtonian gravity is changing. The prefactor that is here is not going to be anymore a constant. So you have something that depends on position, and look, that's x mu, it can even evolve as a function of time. And the evolution is given by the equation of motion of this guy. So in this theory, you're going to have two equations that are coupled. One is for phi, and one is for g. And you need to solve the two simultaneously. So there's a coupled system of equations. Okay? This is just an example to show you what is the variety of theory that you can produce. Scalar, vector, and tensor, or even mixed. And then it's up to your fantasy of building up the theory that you want. The cute thing about this theory is that it can reproduce GR. So GR is encoded in this theory. If you choose with certain conditions, it basically reproduces the Einstein-Fields equation. And this happens when your potential phi is actually a constant, surprise, surprise, equal to g to the minus 1. Then you get GR back. Nice, eh? Good. We shall continue now and dig in into the Einstein-Fields equations instead to get predictions out of it. Because up to this point, you basically have the core mathematical ingredients and the core theoretical understanding to use general relativity. You have your Einstein field equations, you understand conservation of quantities in GR, you know how free particles behave in your in the presence of a curved space-time. You can now work. You can now get your equations and apply it to different systems. So now what I'm going to do is, at first, to linearize our theory. After having a lot of, you know, build up this mega machinery to get a non-linear theory, I will linearize it. And I will linearize it such that we can look for scenarios in which we have, which are used basically in most of the applications. And with most applications, I mean weak fields. For example, in the surrounding of the Earth, for example, in the surrounding of the star. Then you can say, what about the galaxy, which is something gigantic, mega powerful gravitational potential? It's still weak. We will need to drop the assumption of a weak field when we are going to deal with black holes, okay? Or, for example, neutron stars. Then, in this case, when you are dealing not with very massive objects, but objects that are very compact. Whenever you are dealing with very compact objects, in their proximity, the field is not anymore weak. You cannot anymore linearize your theory. You cannot anymore use a perturbative approach to describe their behavior. And you need the full equations. We are going to do this as well. Okay? But this can be done in a reasonable amount of time whenever you're introducing symmetries or whenever your system has certain symmetry properties. For example, a point mass which is not rotating, not doing anything, has a spherical symmetric symmetry. We are going to exploit this spherical symmetry to derive our Einstein field equations in their full power. No assumption is done except for the symmetric scenario. And you get all the fancy predictions that speak about black holes and all the weirdnesses that are taking place in their surroundings. Einstein even believed that they don't exist. They were so weird, he said, this thing cannot exist. The theory predicts that, but probably, it's very likely that in nature, the conditions for which you get to a sort of very compact objects, because you need to squeeze matter quite a lot to get something so compact and produce the black holes that we know, as we know them. So you believe, I don't think that this can happen in nature. But indeed, this happens. Okay, and black holes are actually observed. And we have several observations that are piling up since 40 years, I think. Okay, since the 80s, or even earlier. 70s, probably. Okay? Good. Let's do our first path, in which we are going to linearize the field equations. First, we will be sort of brutal. And we are going to recover Newtonian mechanics. But in doing that, we are going to have additional features, because of course we are consistent with GR. Therefore, we can predict the perihelion shift correctly. We can predict gravitational lensing correctly. And all of that. Okay? Later on, we are going to make, I'm going to take the next following order. Therefore, I'm going to use an approach that gives you other features in general relativity, such as frame dragging, that we are going to see. So let's do that. So let's linearize our equation. Linearized Einstein equations. So what do we do? Well, we use a perturbative approach. What does it mean? That we have our metric, and we assume it to be composed by a Minkowski metric plus a tiny perturbation. Okay? So you see, it's basically Minkowski plus, not quite, there is just a tiny change. And we are going to have that G mu nu is way smaller with respect to the terms of nu. Okay, so these guys are way smaller than these guys, all coefficients. And to show you, just give you a few numbers, if we look at h mu nu, they are of the order of 10 to the minus 6 when we're talking about the sun. And h mu nu is of the order of 10 to the minus 4 when we're talking about the galaxy. And our galaxy is quite a massive one. It's not that small. So you see that this approximation can be applied in many, 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 many different scenarios. Therefore, at first order, g mu nu is roughly nu mu nu, and the inverse metric, g mu nu, is roughly nu mu nu, mu nu plus h mu nu. So this approximation holds. And what we are going to do is to basically plug in this expression in Einstein field theory. Therefore, we will have to compute the Christoffel symbols. Based on the Christoffel symbol, we can compute our curvature. Out of the curvature, we are going to compute the Ricci tensor. And out of the Ricci tensor, we are going to compute the Ricci scalar. Once we have the Ricci tensor and the Ricci scalar, you see that we have the Einstein tensor, because they are the two ingredients of the Einstein tensor. And with that, we have our linearized theory of gravity. And what we will need to do is just to keep the first order terms. So all higher orders are going to be neglected. So, step number one, Christoffel. So, they are alpha ij equal to 1/2 g mu nu, the e g gamma j, plus the j g I gamma minus the gamma G J E. That's Christopher symbols. They are just like that. Then what we do? Well, we just plug in our G mu nu equal to nu mu nu plus H mu nu. So we plug it in here, 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 and here. And what do we notice? Well, that's the derivative of G. Derivative of G. So what are we going to have? The derivative of G mu nu. I will use sigma. And all of these guys are equal to the derivative of sigma of nu mu nu plus derivative of sigma of H mu nu. But what is this guy? Well, that's actually identically zero. Therefore, from here to here, I'm going to have only derivatives of the perturbation. And it does make sense, because the Christopher symbol in a flat space-time is equal to zero, right? Therefore, in a flat space-time, we would have only this guy, and the derivative would be equal to zero, Christopher symbol equal to zero. Do you see? This makes sense. And then here, we have the other fact that we have to think, where is it? Here. This guy have to be thought in terms of the inverse of the metric. Yeah? It doesn't matter, because there's the structure. The structure is so. What we do is to build up a tensorial tensor, so that's valid for all observers. And then, whenever we are introducing that one. Well, you set at infinity equal to zero the potential, for example. And then this allows you to set the values. But then it depends. You know, the quantity is related to the equation of motion of the things that you see, because you're using massive particles, for example, to trace the potential, or better to say, to trace the space-time distortion. And then this is a nearly Newtonian case, and you will get this sets the acceleration that you will get in around galaxies or so on. And also that depends on your frame, because if I'm in a frame which is accelerated somewhere, you know, this acceleration is there, so you know. Okay. So, going back to that, where was I? Oh, okay, so from here to here we are going to get only derivatives with respect to H. Here we need to use the inverse, where we should have first all of this term combined with n mu nu, and all of this term combined with H, right? Because we have a plus in between, right? This expression would end up here with this plus in between. But what happens? That all terms that are related to where I have H, which is coming from here, mu nu. Let's take, for example, this one which is closer to me. The gamma G I J, this G I J, as we said, is going to be substituted by our H J E. And this is second order. Second order, because we have H and H, and it's going to be neglected. Therefore, here we are going to remember the fact that nu mu nu is constant, therefore we are going to have only derivatives with respect to H. We are going to use the inverse of the metric, but we have to keep in mind that whenever we multiply this H by these expressions, we are going to get quantities that are of second order and that can be neglected. And this leads us to 1/2 the alpha delta E H alpha E plus the J the alpha H alpha E minus box H J E minus delta J delta E of H. Okay? So you get the box because you're going to have derivatives Crazy. Let me cancel this thing. Which give us 1/2 delta E H alpha J plus delta J alpha E minus delta alpha H J. These are the Christoffel symbols. What, sorry? No, because we applied it here, you see? This is going to become our, where is it here? Nu mu nu, and then we have the indices that are going to be raised. You see that we have raised indices here. Okay, so that's coming from the metric that is going up. So again, concepts are very simple. Just plug in your perturbed metric, the inverse of the metric, and you keep second order terms. That's it. And you arrive at that. And all the mathematical steps are these three ones. You substitute, derivatives, only this one is going to survive, and whenever you have the application of H to derivative of H, these are second order terms that are going to be neglected. Full stop, nothing more complicated than that. Once we have the Christoffel symbol, we can compute our Ricci tensor. Ricci tensor that is coming from the contraction of the Riemann tensor. Ricci tensor, therefore, we have the contraction with respect to the first and third index, which is, you see, that's repeated twice. And I use alpha and j. I just use the definition of the components of the Ricci tensor that we derived. Then we have the terms with the Christoffel symbols times each other. I don't bother to write down the terms, all the coefficients, because this guy is approximately zero. We are going to neglect it because also this guy is of second order. Second order, because you see we have Christoffel symbol times Christoffel symbol. Therefore, we are going to have something that is something very small, because we have these terms which is very small, times this guy, which is again very small. And you can say, but h is small, the derivative could be still large, right? Because if I have a function which is very steep crossing the zero, this function is zero there, but the derivative can be very large. But that cannot be, because our h mu nu is going to be small, sort of all over the places. It means that if I'm moving from one location to another, the function cannot be steeply rising. Have to be pretty small, such that our h is small all over the places. Okay? Therefore, also the derivatives are going to be very small with the same order of h. Since we have Christoffel symbol, this guy times another Christoffel symbol, this is of second order because I'm multiplying h two times. Okay? Good. Then we do, once we got rid of all of these terms, we just plug in our Christoffel symbols that we derived before. Therefore, we are going to get delta 1/2. Then we have delta alpha, delta E, H, alpha J, plus delta alpha, delta J, H, alpha E, minus delta alpha, delta alpha, H, J, E, minus delta J, delta alpha, H, alpha E, plus delta J, delta alpha, H, I, alpha. And I missed one. Alpha E, alpha J, alpha alpha, J alpha, J E. Stop this one. Minus, minus, delta J, delta E, H alpha alpha, plus delta J, delta alpha, H I alpha. Now, what do we have? Ah, look. I have these two guys, alpha J, J alpha, alpha E, alpha E. But remember that the standard derivatives commute. Therefore, I can flip these two guys. And therefore, this is with a plus, this is with a minus. They cancel each other. Then what do we have? We have an alpha and an alpha. Oh, that's the box operator. And then what do we have here? We have alpha and alpha. This is a scalar that I call H. Therefore, all of that is going to simplify and is going to give us 1/2 delta alpha, delta E, H alpha J, plus delta J, delta alpha E, box, H, J, E, minus delta J, delta E, and H. Now that we have the Ricci tensor, we can get our Ricci scalar. And we have our R, which is going to be our R, J, J. And therefore, this is, again, an approximation, because we are using our Ricci tensor at first order, where we kept only first order terms in H. Delta alpha, delta G, so this is just what I have up here. With the J's repeated, you see J, 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 J. Now we have the contraction taking place. Plus delta J, delta alpha, H alpha J, minus box, H, J, J, minus delta J of H. What do we have? Oof, this is repeated index, that's our box operator. Here we have J and J, therefore this guy is equal to H. Therefore we have this term that are going to be the same. But then look also at the other terms. We have, you see there are these J and J flipped, these alpha and alpha flipped, but I can, you know, this guy is going to be equal. I can basically invert the two the indices, and these two guys are going to be the same. Therefore, these guys and these guys are the same. Therefore, I can sum the two together. I get a 2 times that divided 2, so the 2 and 2 cancel, and we obtain delta J, delta alpha, H, alpha J. These two guys are the same, therefore I get a minus twice this term. The 2 and 2 cancel again. Therefore, I am going to have minus box of H. Nice, we have everything. We have the Ricci scalar, and we have the Ricci tensor. With that, we could just compute our Einstein tensor. Allow me to cancel this one. Einstein tensor, GJ, which is equal to Rij minus 1/2 R Gij. So that's just the definition. Now we have our Ricci tensor and Ricci scalar, where we kept only first order terms in H, and we just plug in all of that stuff inside here. And we get 1/2 delta alpha delta E H alpha J plus delta J delta alpha H alpha E minus box H J E minus delta J delta E of H minus nu I beta delta J delta alpha H alpha beta minus nu I J box of H. And we know that this guy is equal to the constant 8 pi g over c to the power of 4 of our energy momentum tensor, that's I and j. These are our linearized equation of Einstein. You say it's ugly, it's horrible, it's worse than where we started with, it looks more complicated. Yeah, but you can manage it, okay? And what I am going to do in the next after the break, I'm going to rephrase this equation in a more convenient way, and by introducing a gauge. So we have still the freedom to look for an infinitesimal coordinate transformation. This is going to be our gauge, which is called Hilbert gauge or Lorentz gauge, in analogy of what it's done in electrodynamics, right? In electrodynamics, we get our field equations, we can introduce a gauge and get a simpler expression. That's what we are going to do, and you will see how this equation is actually become cute and nice again, okay? With the additional feature that we can actually get some more easily understandable result with physical interpretation, okay? So we can have a break, we can resume. I'd like to finish that, so let's do it in 5 minutes at 25 past 10.